So, yeah, welcome everyone to this week's simulation-based science colloquium. Today we have Raymond Patmos as our speaker. Raymond has a background in nanobiology with a Bachelor of Science and Master of Science degree from both TU Delft and Erasmus MC in Rotterdam. And now he is a fourth-year PhD student at the Computational Science Lab of the University of Amsterdam. Work is supervised by Professor Alfons Hoekstra. And his research, as you see, is focused on cerebral perfusion during ischemic strokes using a multiscale model. And as I'm sure he will tell us about in this talk, this work is part of a larger project called the INSYST project. And excited to hear more about this. Thank you, Raymond, for coming after your first talk already this morning at ICCS. And this was yours.
Yes, thank you. I will indeed tell you about INSYST. That's a few slides in. So I mainly study acute ischemic stroke. So acute ischemic stroke is one of the most common type of stroke. The other one is an aneurysm, which is bleeding. So an acute ischemic stroke is a sudden blockage of a cerebral vessel. And it's responsible for about 3 million deaths every year and a lot of disability and other problems caused by it. So there's a slogan that I like that's called time is brain. So the quicker you treat an acute ischemic stroke, the better the outcome. So as soon as you have a stroke, so there's a blockage in one of the vessels, as I mentioned, and when you have a blockage, tissue starts to die. So the sooner you remove this treatment, this blockage, the better the outcome will be. So some of the common symptoms are left side paralysis and fainting. So when a patient enters the hospital, a quick scan is made, and typically you can see a hyperdense area such as this, which is typically the clot. Sometimes you don't see it at all, but you. So this is with contrast, and this is, I think, without contrast. So here you can see the contrast. So on this side, this is healthy, and here you have a blockage, and this side is less perfused. So I don't know if you can really tell, but less vessels are visible here than on the other side. And so when you have once this is diagnosed, you are given typically thrombolysis, and then you are rushed to do thrombectomy. Sometimes you don't get thrombolysis due to other due to allergies or some other reasons why you cannot have this. So this thrombolysis is so you're given a thrombolytic agent that tries to dissolve the clot, but this is really ineffective, and I think only about a quarter of cases are actually effective with thrombolysis alone. That's typically followed by thrombectomy. So thrombectomy is the mechanical removal of a clot. So a catheter is inserted with a device. So this, you can see here the device. So this is on the order of a millimeter. It's really small. And this is inserted in the clot and then pulled out so that the clot sticks to this and it's mechanically removed. But still, even if the clot is removed, sometime later, you still can have a large infarct. So you can see the infarct. So this is a really bad scenario. This is really like half the brain has died. So this patient is severely disabled. And so we try to model within INSYST. So this is what I'm presenting here is part of INSYST. So INSYST tries to, so there are four parts. So you can divide it in four parts. The first one is to characterize the patients and the clots to generate a patient model. So this overcomes some of the problems that are related to medical imaging with sharing and missing data, etc. So based on all the patient data, you can have a statistical model based on, and you can sample from this based on inclusion and exclusion criteria. So for each virtual patient, you can simulate an infarct and treatment with the models that we try to develop within INSYST. And then for each patient, estimate the outcome similar to a clinical trial. So this is a clinical, an in silico clinical trial for acute ischemic stroke. So I will give you a short brief interview towards every part. So the first is this virtual patient model. So this is a statistical model that's built on the Mr. Clean registry. So this is a registry, a database of all the stroke patients in the Netherlands, what type of treatment they have, imaging characteristics, clinical characteristics like blood pressure, age, that type of thing. And this is used to create a virtual population that also includes all the correlations between all these parameters so that you have sort of a correlated data set. And as you can see, so here, this is typically how it's represented. So the dark color here are all the simulated patients, and the lighter color are all the patients from the registry. And you can see that's a good match. So for each patient, so zooming in, so for each patient, we have this whole pipeline. So this is, Max actually presented this morning at ICCS. And this is where the main part of INSIST is working. So we have different models. So I'm working mainly on 1D blood flow with collateral flow. Oxford is working on perfusion and infarction. A treatment model is done by Milano and Galway. And the virtual patient and the virtual patient outcome assessment model that's done by the AMC and the Erasmus University. So this is a discrete event simulation. So instead of making one large simulation, we have separate models that can be run one after the other. And this works for acute ischemic stroke in this case. It doesn't always work. So you can show it this. So we have one virtual patient and we have four sort of events. So each event is, so we have the baseline event where we have on the blood flow model that I'm working on, as well as the coupled model. So we have both an uncoupled model and a coupled model. These are separate models that you can couple. And the idea is that you can replace easily all the models in the trial so that you sort of have a pipeline that you can execute. You don't need to wait on the other model. You can just update one model without touching the other model. So we have four types of event. First, we have baseline. In this case, it's 1D blood flow, perfusion, tissue simulation. That's all run before there's any clot. Then you have a clot. And we update, we have to update the blood flow simulation, the perfusion simulation. So then an infarct starts to grow and we have a tissue simulation I didn't mention that before, but we have a tissue simulation that will simulate the growth of the infarct over time. We have a treatment, and then we run that again. We run 1D blood flow perfusion again, and finally we come to the end stage, which is typically depending on when we want to compare it. So this can be 24 hours or months after treatment. We can simulate this infarction. So the treatment model itself is comprised of two parts. So we have two models for that, actually. We have thrombolysis, as I mentioned earlier. So this is work by Geneva. This is a movie. I'm not sure if I can play it. No, don't think so. No, so unfortunately, I cannot play the movie, but this is a coarse-grained model of thrombolysis. So we have this. It's coupled. It will be coupled. It's not coupled at the moment to blood flow and perfusion. But the idea is that you have a thrombolytic agent and you have a clot. So this is a heterogeneous clot. So this is the model. I really wish I could have shown you this movie, unfortunately. Let me try to play it anyway. Why does it? No, sorry. I shouldn't do that. No. Oh yeah, now it's playing. Yeah, so you can see this is the simulation, and this is the clot, and you can see it tries to dissolve the clot. It works quite well. So this is currently not integrated in the trial, but the idea is that we will integrate this. So the other model for treatment is thrombectomy. Yes, so here you can see this thrombectomy device that pulls out this clot. And the bottom one is unsuccessful and the top one is successful. And so these will be, these are quite heavy simulations. So these take many days to run. So the idea is that, one idea is that we can replace this by a surrogate model. So in this case, so a surrogate model would take a bunch of simulations and try to sort of create a surface where you can have all the input parameters. Instead of running the simulations, you just give it, give this model the input and it will predict what the output of the model will be. But of course, you have to train this. So this is quite this gives quite a significant speed up. So the idea is to replace the heavy simulations with this model, with a surrogate model that is much faster. So those are the different models. So I will discuss the 1D and 3D models in more detail in the next part of my presentation. So the final model that's in the it's in this trial is the estimation of the patient outcome. So in this case, the outcome will be estimated based on the modified ranking score. So this is a score, a clinical score, based on the severity after the stroke. So 0 is no symptom, 6 is dead, and based on the severity, you can have this score. And the input for this model is the all the patient characteristics as well as all the simulation results. And so this is all run within Docker containers so that you don't have to manually install everything. You can just run this container. So every model, every event has its own container. There's a standard structure, they all plug and play, and you don't have to worry about installing anything. So this is Docker. You also have Singularity for high performance computing. So I just wanted to give you a brief overview of the SIS project. So I just copied some slides. Sorry if it's not that clear. If you have any questions about this part, feel free to ask them now or after the presentation. So I will now talk about what I'm actually doing myself, which is 1D blood flow modeling as well as perfusion modeling, and trying to couple these two models so that you can create a multiscale model. So the reason this is necessary, that it's not just one blood flow model, is that the cerebral anatomy is very they exist on multiple scales. So you have the large vessels, so typically these are typically like starting at the heart. These are on the order of millimeters in radius, and length can be centimeters, so all the way from the heart to the head. So this is the macro scale. So you can see an image of the cerebral circulation with the circle of Willis, which is on my next, which I will discuss in detail on my next slide. So this is the macro scale, which you can typically see on medical imaging. But for the smaller scale, you have different scales, so different sizes. So you have the large scale of the vessels that you don't see in medical imaging, as well as the actual microcirculation. So this is still on the order of hundreds of micrometers, but this is on the few micrometers. So you can so see it as this, this image. So you have the microcirculation that feeds into the pyoartery arteries, that feeds into the descending arteries, that feeds into the capillary bed. So the capillary bed can be captured by is typically captured by an homogenized method, because there are simply too many vessels to simulate them individually. So typically you use something like Darcy for a porous medium solution. And the macrocirculation are typically large arteries, but few of them. So you can typically solve that with either 3D Navier-Stokes or approximations of Navier-Stokes. So the macrocirculation that is in this case simulated by a 1D blood flow model, or the capillary bed is simulated by a tissue model. And I will discuss each of these as well shortly. But there's a problem in coupling these two, in that the scale, the pyoarteries, they're not in either model. So they're too small for the micro scale, but too large for the micro scale. So there's this missing gap. So first the microcirculation. So we have the circle of Willis. So here you can see the brain. And you have the circle of Willis, which is the most important structure, which is why I'm highlighting this. So this is, you have this circle, which is about a centimeter or two in diameter. And it's really at the center of your brain. So blood comes in from the large arteries into this circle, and then it's distributed across the brain to the different hemispheres, the cerebellum, the brainstem, etc. But there's you can have an incomplete circle, which has big consequences if you have a stroke. So if you have a complete circle, which is about half the population, if you have a clot, for instance, in this vessel, then flow can still reach the parts of the brain to the other branches. So yeah, flow can be redirected. But if you have a missing vessel and there's a clot, then this entire region will simply receive less flow. So that's an important variable to consider. So the circle of Willis distributes flow towards the different regions of the brain. So these are all the vessels typically that you can still see in medical imaging. But what you cannot see in medical imaging are typically the vessels of the bowel surface. So here you can see an EM image. I think this is EM, created from EM images at least, many of them. And here you can see these are all the surface vessels of the brain. So this is a side view of the brain. I think the red ones are the veins and the black ones are the actual arteries. So these are below the imaging resolution of CT and MRI. Sometimes you can see them slightly, but usually you can't see them at all. So this is what is missing. So these vessels, they perfuse the brain. And so this is a slice through this to the brain. This is the surface vessel. So the blue ones and the red ones are again these vessels. And they're connected to the penetrating arteries, the descending arteries. The descending arteries then perfuse the capillaries, so the microcirculation, and the microcirculation again flows into the veins and then back to the heart to complete the circle. The penetrating arteries, the capillaries, and the veins, these are captured by a tissue model. But the large arteries, these arteries, the bowel surface arteries, as well as the arteries that connect to these arteries are not directly included in any scans, which is unfortunate. But the vessels that perfuse this are captured. So that is typically done in this case. But in this case, this is done by a 1D blood flow model. So the 1D blood flow model is simply, it's 1D, so that you have a tube and you can have flow from left to right. So this is averaged over the circumference of the vessel. The specific profile is assumed, so you can still have sort of, you can model this as three-dimensional, but typically you just have a mean velocity with a certain profile. In this case, this is a collection of tubes. So here you can see the pressure if you solve this model. So here's the heart. These are the large vessels to the arms. So the vessels here are not to scale. These vessels are really about 0.1 millimeters, but these ones are on the order of 10 millimeters, 20 millimeters in radius. So these are much larger. So here you have the vessels of the neck, and here again you have the circle of Willis and the different side branches of the brain. And each vessel is simulated as a resistance, but the resistance depends on the pressure. So these are elastic vessels. And the brain itself is a finite element model. So you can see the equation. So these are, this is Darcy's law. So you have a source term and flow, and you have three compartments. So you have the arterial compartment, the capillary compartment, and the venous compartment. This is the surface. You have the different binding conditions, so the brain stem and I forgot what it's called. And you have there's a difference between white and gray matter in this case, because they have different permeabilities. And you can solve this model as well separately to have healthy perfusion. But so these are the two different models, but you have to couple these together. So here you can see the coupling in this case occurs to the bowel surface, because this surface functions to distribute the flow. So you have the 1D model again, and this now it's color coded based on the major regions. So here you can see the surface of the brain. Again, color coded based on the major arteries. So these are, here you have the circle of Willis, and the major arteries are the individual vessel that the major vessels from the circumfilus that produce the brain. So this is the left middle cerebral artery, the right middle cerebral artery, and then the anterior and posterior are the different colors. So for each outlet, we have to estimate the surface region on the brain that is perfused by that outlet as a boundary condition for the tissue model. So if you can do one-way coupling, so basically you can solve each model separately. So you can see, so this is the healthy simulation. You have no clot, and this is the pressure. And here you have the healthy perfusion, and there's a big perfusion difference based on the white or gray matter, but this is typically what it looks like. You have higher perfusion in the gray matter and lower perfusion in the white matter. So if you have a clot somewhere here, so here there's a blockage, and if they're not coupled, there will be no flow through the clot. So this entire region basically has zero flow, zero pressure, and you can put that as a boundary condition for the perfusion model, for the tissue model. And you can see that there's a large region where there's basically zero perfusion, but this is not a realistic scenario. So the way to two-way couple this, you have to two-way couple this so that flow, there can be flow through the, so the boundary condition here is that there's no flow anymore through this boundary. It's simply zero flow, which leads to zero, basically to zero pressure or no pressure gradient. But this is neglecting the influence of all these vessels. So there can be flow, because there's a pressure difference, there can be flow from one region to the other. So basically flow from this region can flow to that region, to the pyral surface as well, to the microcirculation. So in order to couple it, so it's already coupled based on the surface regions, but to account for the pressure drop to these vessels, we have to estimate the resistance, so that the pressure drop that introduced by these missing vessels. So the coupling consists of both a mapping and a resistance for each surface region. So and if you apply that, you can see that, so this is again healthy and a stroke, and you can see that there's a big difference in the perfusion during a stroke. So this region receives a lot more perfusion than in the previous case, but the surrounding regions now also receive less, which was not the case previously. So here you can see the difference between the two scenarios. So the left one here and the top one here, these are the one-way coupled or uncoupled scenarios. And you can see there's a big difference between the, so this is the two-way coupled in 1D and the 3D model. So here there's, this basically is zero, but here it's no longer zero. You can see here there's, this is, would be healthy, would be no change from healthy flow, but here there is a change. So basically flow from this region can flow into the affected region, and that's through these vessels. So if we compare, so you can estimate the infarcted volume based on the difference in the perfusion. So here you can see the uncoupled one. Basically this entire region would be infarct volume, and you can calculate what the infarct volume would be. And here is the same type of clot. Everything is the same apart from the coupling condition. So you can see that flow is from one region to the other. There's some flow. So this would be less than there would be here. And you can see here the infarct volume is also much less. So that's almost 40 milliliters in the infarct difference based on this criteria. So you have to set a threshold based on the perfusion. But the coupling also affects the, so this is again the circumfilus. So the coupling also affects the how the infarct would appear. So based on the circumfilus, if you have, so these are all the same clots, but if you have a different circumfilus, you can have a different infarct, and these are very different. This can be 300 milliliters, this is maybe 50, this might be 500, for instance. So if we do the same thing with the model, you can see, so on the left, you can see the model, and on the right is this same region. and see they match quite well. But one thing that we haven't considered so far, which is one of the most important parameters for good patient outcome, is the collaterals. So the collaterals are alternative pathways. So if you have a stroke, you can have, these are vessels between the what are typically separate regions. And during a stroke, these allow for residual flow, which significantly affect the patient outcome. So here you can see, here is a clot. So this is a subtraction angiography. So here you have healthy flow, and this region would normally also receive flow, but now there's less because of this clot. Normally this would be perfused by all kinds of vessels, but if you have collaterals, you can see these are the collateral flows. So this, if you don't have these sort of alternative pathways, then you don't have flow and you have a worse outcome. So you can see here, these are some of the vessels that are between these regions. And this is highly patient, variable between patients. So you can score that, and that's typically done. So here you can see four different classifications. So if you have no collaterals, so actually I should mention, the blue here is the side where there's no clot, and the red here, red vessels are the vessels that are seen after a clot, basically. So the difference in red and blue are basically the more red you see here, the better the collateral score. So that's the vessels that still have flow even though there's a clot somewhere. And you can see here there's so this is graded based on how much of the vessels you see. So here you see 8%, 27%, etc. Here you see all of them, and you can see that there's, even though there's a clot somewhere, there's still good perfusion. So patient outcome would be very, very good. So this is an effect that's even better than any treatment in predicting patient outcome. You can also look at infarct. So here you can see the different grades. So this is the worst. So this is color coded based on infarct. So I think these are for different patients. This is the probability of having that tissue infarcted. So you can see this is a much larger region than here. And this is the effect purely by this collateral flow. And so the main idea is that this collateral flow is because of these vessels that interconnect on the pyral surface. And people have been trying to segment and quantify the pyral surface. So this is for mice or rat. And it's sort of a honeycomb mesh on the surface. That's the best approximation. So what this means for the model is that there can be flow between the separate regions. And that's what I'm trying to add to the model at the moment, is between these regions, there can be this collateral flow. But how to calibrate the strength of this? Because there's very little data on this. So one way is to look at the infarct volume. So here you can see again, these are the different grades. So good perfusion, good collaterals are here. So these are the good collaterals and these are the bad collaterals. And this is the final infarct volume, so after treatment. There is really no data on before treatment, which is a problem, but you can see this is the control and this is the treatment. So you see there's very little effect between the two. But one additional problem is that the threshold sort of perfusion is very time dependent. So if you have a clot, the time after you have a stroke really sets the amount of tissue damage. So the longer you wait until you restore blood flow, the longer it takes for tissue to the more infarct you will have. And so all these infarct volumes are determined many hours. So typically treatment is at least 3 to 4 hours after start of the stroke. So we're hoping that all these data will be in this region, And if that's the case, then we can use this data, these mean values, to calibrate the model. Let me skip this slide. So the collaterals can add sort of a strength of flow, so a resistance again, between the regions. So these are for different collateral scores. So here there's zero, and these are increasing in strength. And you can compare this with the data from literature. You can see it doesn't match that well. But the reason I think that it doesn't match well is that the simulation uses a different method to estimate the infarct volume. There are two reasons so why this doesn't match. The first is that you're basically looking at a slide through, but the vessels that are in the 1D model are missing sort of these vessels here, which is precisely where you don't really see this region. So this region would be infarcted, but is not in the simulation. And I think this is partly because of these missing vessels, but also because of the way that's typically infarct volume is defined in literature and the model. So here you can see on the right, this is the actual perfusion levels. So this is the during a stroke. So you can see here, this is the region that seems to be most effective, but that's not present in this image, even though it's the same simulation. So I think it's basically dependent on how you set this infarct volume, the criteria for infarct volume. So if you use these values to calibrate the strength of the collaterals, so here you can see some simulation results. So these are the threshold in perfusion drop and the infarct volume that would predict it based on what's typically used to define infarct volume in the literature, clinically, I mean. And you can see that so these red lines, these are the different values, the mean values for each of these grades. And if you pick the right threshold to define your infarct volume, you can exactly match these. That's now what I'm looking into. There's not really a good consensus in the literature, and every clinic seems to use a different method to sort of estimate the infarct volume. And it's also dependent on the imaging method. So there's really not a good concise way to characterize the infarct volume, which is a big problem for my simulations. I thought I had another slide. So I've shown you a way to characterize, two-way couple the a 1D model with a 3D tissue model through the pile surface, as well as estimating the effect of the missing vessels. So with that, I would like to end. If you have any questions, feel free to ask. Stop sharing my screen.
Great. Thank you very much, Raymond. Great presentation. And, really exciting research. In my eyes, I already see a raised hand by Gabor. So please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks. Hey, Ramon, thanks for the really nice talk. I, of course, am really familiar with your part of the work. So if you don't mind, I would like to ask something about the global model that you are using, because you showed quite a few components. And I understand that the coupling between them at the moment is more like every model hands over data that is necessary for the next one. But I was thinking that there would be a really good opportunity in deeper integration. And let me give you an example. And I would like to know if that exists in the plans or not. For instance, you showed two different models, one for lysis, one for thrombectomy, chemical dissolving of the thrombus and mechanical removal. And it would be super interesting, in my opinion, if these could be more deeply integrated, meaning that, for instance, when you have a specific patient who has a given thrombus composition, you could do some decision-making support simulation saying that, okay, I should use ATP or whatever chemical constant to some extent, then use mechanical removal of the thrombus, or based on the composition, it's better to purely use chemical dissolving, or it's better to use a bit of dissolving, then go into thrombectomy, meanwhile also administering more ATP. So I imagine that most of the treatments are not either of these methods and not the other, but it's a combination of things. So it might be interesting to do some sort of integration between these components. So how do you see that? Is that happening or will that happen? What's the situation with that?
Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah, it would be really interesting if we could do that. I don't think that would be feasible anytime soon, mainly because these two models are really quite complicated. So this thrombectomy model is, I'm not that familiar with the details. I think they are working on trying to add this this thrombolysis, but I don't know if it's really feasible to do both.
Okay.
I don't think, so typically thrombectomy is really fast, especially so the entire procedure might take half an hour, but that's including inserting the catheter and everything. So I think from a, in this case, what we're trying to do, I don't think it really will have a big impact. But there are simulations or attempts to sort of have these thrombectomy devices that are coded in this TPA, in this thrombolytic agent.
Yeah, but I mean,
maybe, but that's different.
Whenever you are doing thrombectomy, you also administer ATP, so chemical spolysis. And I would understand it the way that if you administer, for instance, too much, then you increase the risk of breaking of parts or breaking of.
Yes.
You can then much more difficult to handle afterwards.
Yes, that actually, you know, they are working on trying to characterize what the effect of thrombolysis is on the mechanical properties of the clot. Mm-hmm. So depending on the thrombolysis treatment, the mechanical properties of the clot will change, which will affect, of course, the thrombectomy simulation. But I don't know if that's really feasible within the time there we have left in the consortium.
Yeah, right. Okay, thank you.
That's really a few years' work, I would say. So sorry, I disabled my camera. It's acting up. I'm not sure why.
So I'm wondering, when is the NCIS project finishing? Is it this year?
It used to be this year, but you got 6 months extension due to Corona. So it's somewhere next year, I think June-ish, June or before that.
Yeah, any more questions?
It's the idea that Gabo had is really outside the scope of the project, but it would be interesting to be able to have a simulation like that.
Okay, I'll drop a question. I'm always really amazed by this circle of Willis. I'm not sure if you mentioned how exactly is it implemented in your model. Do you manually choose the completeness, let's say, or you show those population distributions? Is that somehow implemented, or how it's?
It's not implemented directly, but it should be captured by this virtual population model. I don't know exactly which parameters are in the virtual patient model. There are a lot of them. But for me personally, I can pick the configuration that I want. So the effect of the circle of Willis, like the, unless the radius of the individual vessels are really small, the variability in the size of them doesn't really matter. So it's more like, is there a vessel or is there not a vessel that really determines this the difference in configuration.
More questions? All right. Yeah, if there are no more questions, then thank you again, Raymond, for giving this great talk today. And so next week will be the last talk for this season of SPS. And next week we will have Philip Steer from the University of Oxford talking about cloud and aerosol physics and the role in climate change, of course. And hope you can join next week, and otherwise a nice weekend to everyone. Thanks again, Raymond.
Thank you. Have a good weekend.